So we've been talking about that, talking about the census and whether you object to it, whether you trust it, or whether, like me, maybe you're softening to the census a bit because you're realising it's all the other stuff that's the problem. Or maybe you're still sens-suspicious. That's good, isn't it? Sam Armstrong is from the Henry Jackson Society and joins me live via video link. Sorry we're coming to you a bit late, Sam. Thanks for waiting.
There's nothing I'd rather do on a lockdown Thursday evening than chat with you, Krista.
Thank you, and very flattering indeed. I don't believe a word of it. Tell me, do you think that actually I'm onto something here? Because I started off this programme, Sam, furious about the census, when in actual fact, that's been around as a means of collecting information about us for longer than anything else. And in actual fact, it's not the census where it all started I should be annoyed about, but it's all the other layers that have come since that are the problem.
Well, that's right. The Census Act, the piece of legislation that initiated the census, was passed in 1800. The first census was in 1801. They've been counting all of us and listing us all by names since 1841. That makes it about 160 years, I suppose. If you've ever gone back and tried to plot out your family tree, you may well have used the census and relied on it and been able to track back and seen if your family was anything like mine, a long line of coal mine heavers in County Durham for generation upon generation upon generation. So the census has been around for a while, but the difference between all then is back in the Victorian era, back in the early Edwardian era, the state we think of as having played a similar role to what it does today, quite a large one. But in actual fact, it was only making up in terms of spending from 5, 10, 15% of every pound spent in the economy. Today, that's very different. Today, the state is right up there at 40%. We just saw in the last budget that the amount of money that the state is taking in tax is going to rise to its highest ever level since 1970, I think. Back up to 36, 37%. And as a proportion of that sort of overall economic activity, the state, the government has risen from 10% of our lives to 40%, from 1 in 10 things that are happening to 4 in 10. And that's a massive shift in a relatively short period of human history.
And I mean, I think my anger is being directed towards this other layer that's come along suddenly now, when we've been living, and look, rightly or wrongly, whether you agree with lockdown or not, whether you agree with the heavy-handedness of some of it or not, that's a debate for another day, but it's something we've been living with for the last year. What I think has been unforgivable is some of the opportunism that I was talking about around it. You know, they're trying to take away our rights when it comes to protests. They're trying to take away our rights to drive across London as a result of the pandemic. And when you look at it from that respect, when you look at it from the tax respect, when you look at it from the fact that we no longer have a small government libertarian ideology here in the UK, I feel like we're heading towards sort of authoritarian times, when we also have more information available about us than any other time in history. Is there an argument to actually say, well, maybe the census isn't needed anymore? You know, you're not going to need it to be looking up your relatives in years to come, because the Facebook profiles will probably still be active. You're not going to need it to know how many school places are needed, because local authorities have never had more information about us in history.
Well, there's definitely a case there. I think last year more data was stored on servers, on systems, than in all of the years previous to it put together. So every year we are now increasing the level of data stored on human beings exponentially. And you only need to look at communist China to see where all this ends. There, everybody's given a score. It's a social credit. If you cross the road without looking, you're marked down. If you jump the queue, you're marked down, and your score dictates how much services you can act. And there is a great irony, of course, to COVID, that this all started in a communist system where everything is tracked, and they were at the very least slow to tell the world what was going on. And by virtue of that, the disease spread, and with it, that the same authoritarianism in China has spread across the world with it. We now can't protest in China. You can't protest. We now can't meet without permission of the state. In China, you can't meet without the permission of the state. And, Ronald Reagan had this old phrase that freedom is never more than a generation away from extinction. And I think the point is that given the choice, a bureaucrat, a public health official, whatever form they might take, they're never knowingly going to refuse the chance to take more control, to have that much more power. And our responsibility, all of us, should be to hold that in check wherever possible, because absent that check, it will just increase on a ratchet.
Because how have we ended up here? I know COVID, I get COVID, but I also worry that, and I criticise Boris Johnson a lot on this programme because I call him the windsock prime minister, because he'll blow in whatever direction that the wind tends to take him. And I don't understand why we have this situation. Let's take aside lockdown. Take that away, because I think that that is a particular set of circumstances. And there are going to be some people that agree that with that set of circumstances. I happen to agree that there were parts of it that were the least worst option. My worry is, well, you answer this. Are we moving aside from lockdown to a more authoritarian regime? And how have we ended up in this with supposedly a libertarian prime minister?
Well, that's the remarkable thing about Boris Johnson, that if you go back on YouTube now and search Boris Johnson clips, you can find him arguing against the smoking ban. You can find him arguing against wearing seatbelts in cars, laws requiring people to wear seatbelts. Instinctively, he's not with any of this. But the public health officials always believe that they're on your side. So there's two points here. The first is to say, do any of us seriously believe that post this lockdown, they're just going to go back to just saying, right, well, this is over. It's fine. COVID is done. Go back to living your lives as you were before. We don't need to check. We don't need to monitor. We don't need to put rules or always be holding your ability to socialize in jeopardy. Really? When the flu is back next year, do we think they're not going to try their arm at triggering?
Do you really think that? Because that kind of thing scares me. I believe that lockdown, well, I believed in the first lockdown. I believe we've ended up with the subsequent ones because Boris wasn't strong enough in the first lockdown. I believe most people were on board with the first lockdown. I think that they understood the reasons why. And I think that Boris wasn't enough of a strong leader to come out of it slow enough that we didn't end up back to square one. That's my belief about all of this. What you say frightens me, because that makes me feel like I've been duped, and that in actual fact, it's sort of bordering on the conspiracy theory.
Well,
I mean, I don't know, have people like me, in your genuine opinion, been duped? Do you really think that they're going to say, right, sorry, we're never coming out of this in some way, shape or form?
I just think it's very difficult for people to ever give up powers that they currently have, right? Nobody wants to be less powerful than they are. Nobody wants to have less control of what other people are currently doing. And look at the overall trajectory in the public health space. 15, 20 years ago, if you wanted to go buy a packet of cigarettes, you go pick them up. They had labels on them. They had pictures on them. They didn't have warnings on them. You could see them. Now people can't be trusted to do that. If you buy alcohol today, it's got a warning. Almost all bottles have a voluntary warning, but there's a lot of steps towards making that mandatory. The safetyism of our schools. We've seen children banned from playing tag and bulldog. There is a creeping belief amongst a part of the public health lobby that the public cannot be trusted to make decisions. Now, they might be right on a good number of those. It's really not for me to say. But what I would say, as somebody who's been watching this, is that if you give them the
the choice, if you just put the choice in the hands of the public health officials, and this isn't necessarily Chris Whitty or Patrick Vallance, it's a whole industry that's popped up to support this kind of notion, this belief that the public aren't to be trusted. If you just leave it to them, they will always choose more power. It's not a surprise, that's a human instinct. And they've had the moment, the opportunity of their life when it's come to coronavirus. They've had more power thrust into their hands than they've ever seen, and they know what to do with. They couldn't even enforce all of the rules. They got that complicated. They got that comprehensive.
But Boris didn't know half of them.
I didn't know half of them. Great,
yeah, but you're not prime minister, with respect, Sam. You're not. You don't need to.
Indeed, but this is what happens, right? None of these laws had to go through Parliament. None of these laws had to be debated. The government just put them up on the website, and that was that. They were law. We all had to follow them. If you didn't follow them, you could get fined. If you didn't pay the fine, you went to prison. And I think they're just going to find it really, really hard to give that kind of power up.
Going back to sort of the information held on us, what I find frustrating is that I feel like, oh God, and it does tie into a lot of what you're saying, but I feel like we've never had a situation where we are more watched, more information is held on us. Our councils are suddenly very efficient when it comes to tracking us down for council tax or tracking us down with a parking ticket. Amazingly, then they've never been better at those sorts of things, but when it comes to actually services, they're diabolical. What are the areas of life intrusion, not just with the public health aspect, but some of the examples I've given about data being held, that worries you the most?
Well, big data is massive. It's completely changed our society. I mean, one area I'll give you that I've always found fascinating is, I think within the next 5 to 10 years, you're not going to be able to buy anything with cash. You're not going to be able to go into a shop and just say, you know, here is a fiver, let's have a packet of sweets. Everything is going to be done by cards. It's going to be done by contact.
You know, we speak a hell of a lot about that on this programme, and about we use the term on this programme a lot about sleepwalking into a digital dictatorship.
Yeah, look, I think that's right. And, you know, in a sense, it's convenient. But do we really like the idea that you can't purchase anything without it being checkable? That there will be a permanent historical record of the fact that, you know, at age 17, you walked into the corner shop and bought a magazine off the top shelf? Do we really want that to be stuck around forever? Do you want your HR records from work in your first ever job to be permanently on some database somewhere that anyone can go and click Control F? And this is another great, interesting area, which is that we're now seeing a generation of people brought up who have now reached the age of maturity, who were going through adolescence just as the digital revolution was broken through. You're going to see politicians in about 5-10 years going for really senior positions into the cabinet, and someone's going to go back through their Facebook and say, aha, but age 14, you decided it was a good idea to take a photo of you wrapping somebody up in cling film and sticking them in the bin. You were a bully at school or whatever. I don't know what it will be, but you will see that. And I think as a society, we might just be actually losing our capacity to forget, to live and let be, to just let things slide, to just let things go, because everything's so easy to find. You just, when it's all on the database, when it's all online, you just search it. It doesn't really matter if it's old. It's just as easy for a computer to find it, no matter how old it is.
But I don't know whether you saw, I know we've got to go because we've got to get to a break, but there's a story we talk about a lot on this programme about the woman who was, I can't remember the name of the political party, but it was a particularly unsavoury political party with racist views. And she found herself without any of her bank cards working. and that's because her bank had gone through her Facebook page and found some of these unsavoury views and used the terms and conditions to close her account down. And that meant she had no access to her money, no access to any form of being able to spend until the cheque was issued at the end of the month. She didn't even have any explanation, as the bank's terms and conditions state that you don't need to give an explanation. Now, I loathe racists. I loathe people with extremist views. But I think it's a very, very worrying road that we go down when the data held on you on a Facebook page will determine your access to the basic services that you need to have to be able to live your life.
Because you'd be absolutely amazed at, you know, how many of these services we use that are commercial services. They're not controlled by the state. But we've entered into terms and conditions that allow them to cancel things without giving us any reason. You can lose your social media accounts, you lose the right to speak, you can lose your banking. And that can be just these agencies that can mark you a politically exposed person or somebody with unsavory views or anything. You can lose all of these. And when it's companies rather than the state, what you lose is that due process, those ancient rights that we have earned over the years as a people, hard for. They've been won in the difficult way with blood, to due process, to the idea that, you know, if somebody wants to take something away from you, they've got to prove it. They've got to go out there, they've got to prove it. Not to themselves, but to 12 ordinary members of the community. I think it's a really dangerous, actually, idea to throw that away just as part of a convenient move towards a digital age. And it's probably one of these areas where, actually, bizarrely, the state has got to be a little bit authoritarian, imposing our rights for the companies not to become authoritarian.
It's sort of the state needs to be authoritarian to give us the freedom that the state have allowed to be taken away from us, which is an irony, really. Sam, really good to talk to you. Well, I think really good to talk to you. Actually, I don't know if I've enjoyed it that much, because I don't know if I feel better afterwards, but I appreciate you taking the time. That's Sam Armstrong from the Henry Jackson Society.